and break all the crosses, and kill all the enemies of Islam, slaying the swine and killing the Dajjal, and then handing over the empire, the conquests, to the Muslims who have not done a jot of effort in the cause of Allah, are sadly mistaken. For that Messiah has come. Islam will not fulfill the requirements of the time by the empty or ritual incantation of prophecies or prayers. What is needed are prayers of such intensity, electric prayers that give life to the dead world. Great exertions are needed. Tadbir, human effort, must combine with takdir, divine decree, to bring about that grand promise. And if we look at the example of the prophets of Islam and the progress of Islam, we should realize, and all people should realize, that only through toil and sweat, through perseverance and patience, through struggle and sacrifice, has the message of God ever been successful. And this is the recipe that the Jamaat-e-Ahmadiyya follows in its daily life. The ailments then of our time are many. In place of a belief in Allah, there is a belief in the maturity and independence of man. Instead of pursuing the pleasures of Allah, the pleasures of the world are pursued. And from this basic ailment flow all the ills of society. Permissiveness of every sort, lack of respect, lack of morals, global drug problems, and the tearing of the fabric of society. How does Islam then tackle these issues? Well, it goes to the root. It teaches the belief in an ever-living Lord who answers the prayers of his servants. The modern world is marked perhaps more than anything else by the age of reason, by the secular advancement of mankind. And modern societies, which are very educated and very inquisitive, are no longer willing to accept the answer that you hear from the priests and others. Have faith, my child, have faith. This is unanswerable and unquestionable. Just follow it. This is not the way of Islam. It brings to mind one of my favorite quotes on a book about Voltaire. In his critique, John Morley writes that wherever there is a duty to worship the sun, it is pretty sure to be a crime to examine the laws of heat. Not so in Islam. An inquisitive mind is called for, is required, and is encouraged. Islam does not only reconcile science and religion, but science proves the veracity of the claims of Islam. One only need look at the Quranic verses and teachings about the origins of mankind or the creation of the universe, and then see modern science and modern research to say how true the Quran is that was revealed to an illiterate man 1400 years ago in the deserts of Arabia. How can anyone say that this message is anything other than true and anything other than a divine revelation from Allah Almighty? The Quran says, encouraging this analytical approach to religion, say, this is my way. I call unto Allah on the basis of reason, I and those who follow me. Chapter 2, verse 109. The promised Messiah himself has noted this very great beauty of Islam, which distinguishes it from all other religions, and which helps prove how great a message it is for the needs of the time. Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salam writes in Tablighi Risalat, volume 6, page 114, a unique feature of Islam is that it does not rely upon old stories, nor upon the doubtful satisfaction which such stories bring. Instead, it relies upon living signs, which it offers to the satisfaction of all inquirers. The living religion, which teaches a living God, a God who will reveal himself to us directly, without an intermediary. So I give the world the glad tidings that this living Lord is the Lord of Islam. This, in fact, is a very deep issue, which could take up many, many speeches. But in brief, the Holy Quran repeats time and time again that the Lord is living, and that communion with that Lord is possible. Millions of Ahmadis attest to the truth of this teaching. Accordingly, from that starting point, winning Allah's pleasure becomes the goal of all Muslims. And how does one win Allah's pleasure? We can't do anything for Allah. He needs nothing from us. All we can do is worship Allah and be humane and kind and charitable to His servants. And then in a society where everyone is humbling themselves to Allah, where everyone is vying with each other in good things, how can anything else but harmony ensue? The hell that can be this world can be transformed to the heaven on earth. But how to get the world to that Islam? How to get the spiritually deaf to hear and the spiritually blind to see? This is the time. The answer is that this is the time of Jihadi Akbar, where every Muslim and every person is required to rededicate themselves to the cause of Allah and transform themselves into re-embodiments and true examples of the message of Islam. This is also the time of the jihad with the sword of the pen. We see around us that the enemies of Islam deliberately seek to blacken its name and throw dirt on the glory of its messenger, the Holy Prophet of Islam, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. One crusade, of course, is finished. It is over. But anyone with a jot of insight can see in the world around us that there is another crusade which has been waged against Islam and the message of Islam. It is a crusade which is far more invidious and pernicious and dangerous to the cause of Islam. It's a crusade which seeks to mock Islam and its messenger. And Islam is spoken of in most condescending words. Islam is viewed as a pitiful religion. But the opponents of Islam do not realize that we pity them. For while they mock the veil, God has placed a veil of darkness over their eyes, and they will not see till all around them become Muslim and accept its divine message. So the task of today, the requirements of this time, requires that all the allegations and calumnies against Islam be wiped off, and that its shining, pristine name dazzles the world as it did at the time of the Holy Prophet of Islam. The battle for the hearts and minds and souls of mankind is to be won using love and kindness and compassion. As the promised Messiah has said, the jihad of this time is to strive in upholding the word of Islam, to refute the objections of the opponents, to propagate the excellences of the Islamic faith, and to proclaim the truth of the Holy Prophet, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, throughout the world. It is therefore imperative that all the resources of the modern media be geared towards this end, not only to defend Islam, but to attract humanity to its divine message. And this is exactly what the Jamaat Ahmadiyya is trying to do. Everywhere in the world, leaflets, magazines, books, conferences, question-answer sessions are being held to show people what Islam really is. MTA International is another example of how Islam needs to engage every resource of the modern time in order to spread the message of Islam as far widely as possible, so that we fertilize the soil of the world and make sure that people are not unaware of the beauties of its message. In Surah Al-Balad, the Holy Quran points out two roads to man, the highway of good and the highway of evil. It acknowledges that the highway of good is a steep ascent, but it also explains exactly where that road is and what its climbing entails. The Holy Quran says, "It is the freeing of a slave, or feeding on a day of hunger, an orphan near of kin, or a poor man lying in the road." The first centuries of Islam, of course, saw the abolition of slavery in Muslim countries, but the rest of the world followed much, much more slowly. In fact,